Blackstone Audio presents Grab the Dream, Your Step-by-Step Guide to Wealth Management by David W. Engen. This book is read by Wayne Evans. Disclaimer: the content of this book is provided as general information only and should not be taken as investment advice. All book content, including mentions of specific companies or individuals, shall not be construed as a recommendation to buy or sell any security or financial instrument or to participate in any particular trading or investment strategy. The author may or may not have a position with any company or advertiser referenced above. Any action that you take as a result of information, analysis, or advertisement in this book is ultimately your responsibility. Consult your investment advisor before making any investment decisions. The author is not an investment advisor and tries not to make investment decisions. He tries to provide some useful information, especially concerning lifestyle choices, and add his own analysis. All the content in this book is solely an expression of the author's personal opinion. Nothing here is intended as investment advice. If you seek investment advice, consult a registered qualified investment advisor. Introduction. Kelvin.
I've decided I want to be a millionaire when I grow up.
Dad. Well, you'll have to work pretty hard to get $1 million.
No, I won't. You will.
Me?
I just want to inherit it.
Circa 1990.
I'm going to make so much money, I said, rubbing my hands together expectantly. It was the summer of 1990, and I had just completed my freshman year at Purdue University.
I was home for the summer, ready to take on a summer job and save up some money for the most important thing in the world to any 20-year-old red-blooded American male. It really is the quintessential motivation that can get us out of bed every morning. I was going to buy a super cool, high-powered muscle car and impress the ladies. After all, what item more accurately reflects your status in society or your place among your peers than a cool set of wheels? I could see it clearly. It would be red and sleek and have two doors and leather seats and get real crummy gas mileage. When I drove down the road, people would shoot me the thumbs up and say, "Nice ride, man." Girls would respect me and guys would envy me. It was going to be great. My parents had informed me that it would be a cold day in hell before they bought me a car. To their credit, they stood by this decision. They were, however, willing to allow me to use the family car for the summer to amass my fortune. It was more, or less, the car of my dreams. Instead of being red, it was silver. Instead of having two doors, it had four. Instead of having leather seats, it had gray Lavoir-covered seats that could be mistaken for sofas. And instead of saying Corvette, Mustang, or Challenger, it proudly flew the flag of Oldsmobile Cutlass Sierra. I don't want to paint an unfair picture of the car they so generously entrusted me with. To be clear, it was just about as righteous as a four-door family car could be. Not all the paint was peeling off the hood, and the squeal from the alternator belt wasn't totally deafening each time I depressed the gas pedal. Two of the power windows still worked, and I could crank that baby up to 50 miles an hour in about a minute flat. It had a kickin' tape deck and ample trunk space. Truth be told, it really didn't leak all that much oil. As for checking off all the boxes of my dream car criteria, the Oldsmobile did fulfill one objective. It got really crummy gas mileage. The deal was simple. I was responsible for all the costs of the car. Gas, oil, changes, maintenance, and insurance were all my responsibility. No worries, I thought. Nothing will stand in the way of my objective of obtaining the ultimate status of American success. I set out looking for a summer job worthy of my talents and skills. CEO of a major company would work. I quickly learned that 1 year of introductory biology didn't quite qualify me to run a major corporation for 3 months during the summer. I ended up working 3 part-time jobs that summer.
My first job was at JCPenney Optical, where I assisted customers in picking out and sizing frames after they emerged from their exam with the optometrist. I would later deliver the finished glasses to the customers and make any minor adjustments to ensure a proper fit. My second job was working as a teller at a bank, assisting customers with deposits and withdrawals. And finally, job three was employment in the theater industries. I was the popcorn boy. It took a lot of careful scheduling and long hours, but I was able to hold down all three jobs at the same time. I was diligent in saving my hard-earned proceeds. I didn't really spend much on entertainment. I wasn't really the partying type, and I never ate out. By the time I got to the end of the summer and dropped the keys of the family sedan back into my father's hand, I reflected on what I was able to accomplish that summer. It was disheartening. I opened my heart to my father, looking for empathy, and in exasperation, I explained to him, "Dad, I've worked three jobs all summer long. I haven't spent any money irresponsibly, and almost everything I've earned has gone into supporting that stupid car." Dad paused, thought introspectively for a moment, and looked me square in the eye as a smile slowly crept across his face. He laughed while he told me, "Welcome to the real world." Circa 2017. My 19-year-old daughter was returning home from her first year at college. She was a high school valedictorian, all-city athlete scholar, an accomplished gymnast, as well as a runner in cross-country and track. She had earned a 4.0 GPA in her first year at college, and by all rights was feeling very proud of her accomplishments. She now needed to bide her time until school resumed in the fall. We have been blessed with three wonderful children brought into this world in well-planned three-year intervals. As with all good, pushy helicopter parents, our kids were constantly involved in sports and other after-school activities. It took ingenious, well-crafted time-and-motion flowcharts for my wife and me to map out who would take which child where and when handoffs would occur, and how we ultimately would all end up at the same home at the end of the evening. There were some nights when I would crawl into bed and poke my wife just so I could see her face once before the day was up. I found myself yearning for holidays, such as Thanksgiving and Christmas, so we could all sit down at the same table, if even for one brief moment in time. Our house is in the countryside, away from pretty much everything. Carpooling was out of the question. We both had large gas-guzzling SUVs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.